And if he's from Harlem, there's no use of even trying. Just like the tide, his mind comes and goes. Like much weather when he'll change. Nobody knows, nobody knows. The man I love, well, he just turned me down. He's a Harlem Brown. Oft times I wish that I were in this ground, 6 feet underground. He idolized me, yes, no other could, no, no. Then he surprised me, leaving me a note saying he's gone for good. And since my sweetie left me hollow, well, it ain't the same old place. Though a thousand dandies smile right in my face, I think I'll move some homemade hooch and go out for a lark, just to drive up these mean old Harlem blues. You can have your Broadway, give me Lenox Avenue. Angels from the sky stroll Seventh, and for that, thanks I do. From Madam Walker's beauty shops to Poirot's system too, that made those girls angels without any doubt. There are some spots up in Harlem where I'm told it's sudden death to let somebody see you. Even stop to catch your breath. If you've never been to Harlem, then I guess you'll never know the power of these mean old Harlem blues. Ah, this one sweet spot in Harlem known as Drivers Row. Titty folks, some call 'em. One thing you should know is that I have. Put some music to my troubles and call them Harlem blues. To put some music to my troubles and call them the Harlem blues. Harlem, the Harlem blues.
You know, I need to put an applause track in this show. Maybe when I do a post-production, I'll put the applause track in. That was beautiful and wonderful. My friend, CYNDA Williams. I'm going to tell you a little bit about her before I bring her. Well, she's already here. You see her right there. You know, one thing I didn't know about you, CYNDA, is that you changed your name to CYNDA to avoid conflicts with CYNDA Williams. Mm-hmm. I mean, moment we saw that. One of my favorite films is also One False Move and Tales of the City Channel. And you hail from Indiana. So I'm not going to get into a whole prolonged introduction of you because in my mind, you are a legend. That film, Morbid of Blues, is my favorite Spike Lee film until I start talking about Malcolm X, and that one is. But anyway, certainly this film is legendary, and I had to play that in its entirety because mm-hmm. when that film was out and I had the soundtrack, I played that song over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. Without further ado, to my audience, welcome to Carl Gilliard's How Do I Know You? Welcome, my friend, the legendary and beautiful, wonderful, and talented CYNDA Williams.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. I lived in Indiana. I was conceived in Indiana. But my mother had me in Chicago, and that's where the first 14 years of my life. So I guess like you kind of say I'm from both. I'm from Indiana, conceived, and ended up living there through high school and college, and then went to Chicago. But it was in Chicago first, yeah.
Well, you know, we kind of crossed paths before we knew each other, because I'm from Chicago originally.
Mm-hmm.
And lived in Detroit for a while. And Ball State, you went to Ball State.
Yes, I sure did.
I used to date a girl in Ball State.
Oh, okay.
I used to drive down there. I was living in Grand Rapids, Michigan at the time. Mm-hmm. And I would drive to Ball State every weekend for about 2 months until I just had to stop. I just couldn't do it.
Yeah,
but I know the campus, beautiful campus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really pretty now too. It's
yeah.
It's so upgraded, yeah. It's beautiful.
So you're in Indiana now?
No. I am temporarily right now in Minneapolis, but I'll be going back to Chicago in the next week or so. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. So how do you like Minneapolis?
I do. Unfortunately, it's a short time here. So most of my experience has been 6 months of winter, which was really pretty for like the first month. And then I've never been in a place where the snow never melted. It never melted. And literally, there's still snow outside right now. And it's 82 degrees because the hills. Yeah, the hills of snow are so high that it's going to take some time for them to completely disappear. But yeah, longest winter of my life. But it's a beautiful, beautiful place. So many lakes, which is my favorite body of water. And I have some a really good friend here and spent some time here, did some work here. And so it was a great experience. Plus, it's, you know, where Prince was from and he was my fave. So though I never got to work with him, I feel like a soulful closeness to him here.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you ever met him?
No. Well, no, not really. I had, you know, one of those 1 degree of separation kind of situations. One of my best friends used to date him and remained very close to him throughout the years. So I would go with her to some of his concerts. He would always give her tickets. And so I got to, you know, he would nod at me and stuff like that, but it wasn't, it was never a hangout session. My brothers and I don't know if Prince is their favorite, but I know he's one of their favorites and he was my favorite. You know, it was like Michael or Prince. And I love Michael Jackson, but Prince was my dude.
Do you think he knew who you were?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, he knew who I was. Oh yeah, yeah. I always wanted to perform with, you know, do music with him. That was my dream. But I heard this about him. I don't know if it's true or not, and he's not around to verify.
Right.
But I heard that he really did not like singers who did not know how to play an instrument.
Really?
And I mean, he just thought that, you know, that was a waste of an ability that you should have if you're a singer. And I agree with him. I just grew up in a household full of kids and very little money. So taking lessons on any instrument was an expense that my parents couldn't afford. And once I started acting, it kind of life kind of went that direction. So I just never did. I might. I don't know. You never know. I'm learning Spanish now. I've been working on Spanish about, you know, a year and a half, and never thought I'd learn another language. So, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm literally taking one moment at a time in my life.
Well, Cindy, you know, the theme of this podcast is I get teased often about how I know everybody, which is not really it's not really true.
Mm-hmm.
I just know a lot of people. So I have to ask you a question. You may not remember. I do, though, because it's my job to know. How did I meet you? How do we know each other?
Well, I've met so many people at events and things like that. Although I'm a very shy person, an introvert. So I didn't spend a lot of time in streets or parties. I wasn't invited to much because I was kind of shy. But we worked on a movie together. And you played my husband, and I know that's when we met, Divine Intervention. And that was so much fun. It was the first time that I'd ever been able to be I think it was my first time I was in a comedy, and I got to do a little bit of comedy, So I was really thankful to be in that. And I love Van Elder, who directed and produced that project. I worked on him on something else that never came out. I don't know what's up with that. Mm-hmm. But it was so wonderful to meet everybody. I really loved and respected all the legends that worked on that, including you. And so, yes, that is how I know I met you.
Yeah, well, you know what? You know, sometimes when I do these shows, people don't remember. Mm-hmm. But that's correct. You have the picture up. Then you know, mm-hmm. legends. You know, we had my boy Red. You got mm-hmm. James Avery, Roz Ryan, Laz mm-hmm. Alonso. And there you are with me.
Mm-hmm.
Picture mm-hmm. right. That's right. Mm-hmm. And when I found out you were playing my wife, I was like, oh my God, I was so excited. But the only thing I didn't like about it is that we didn't have any real scenes together.
No, we did not. We did not. I think that picture there sums up the time that we spent. And it's that way on so many projects that I've worked on. You know, there's all these great actors in the project, but I don't necessarily have any scenes. Like when I did Caught Up, I think it was LL that played my husband, LL Cool J, I think.
Yeah, was that LL? Who was in that film with you? I was actually It was LL,
I think he played my husband. Right. But we never were in a scene together. I played twins in that movie, and his wife got murdered by me. She was like my doppelganger. We weren't sisters, but we looked exactly alike, and I killed her or so, I think.
Right.
Memory serves. But anyway, he sees me laying up, tied up and dead on the bed. But it was just a shoot, you know. They shot me and at one time shot him in another. So I never really got to meet him. People come up to me, oh my gosh, you got to do this movie with this person and that person. I was like, yeah, but I never met him.
So is that LL in this picture here? Can you see the picture?
No, that's Bokeem Woodbine.
That's what I thought it was. I thought it was Bokeem.
Yeah, like, yeah. He played the male lead in this movie, and I was his co-star in this film. But Darren Scott is who wrote, produced, and directed this movie. He'd had already so many hits out there from what he had written. He wanted to direct, and then this was, I don't know if this was the first movie he directed or the second. It was very early in his directing life. So he knew all these people from all these other movies. So he was able to get a lot of names in the film, and it was great, but I didn't meet him. I did almost everything with Bokeem Woodbine, and I Basil Wallace, I think, was in it.
Oh,
was,
yeah, I know Basil.
Yeah, I think he played the bad guy. Mm-hmm. And what's his name? Is it Carl? Carl something, another Carl that I've done a few movies with, that's in a billion movies. He's in everything. I can't remember his last name. I'm totally blocking it. For some reason, it's not in my head, but right. Yeah, I worked with like two people, and then you know who I got to know on this movie, and he became huge, but I can't remember his name. He was the big guy in The Green Mile.
Oh, Michael Clark Duncan.
Yes, he was a small extra. He was an extra in it. And we met on that movie, and I just thought he was the most wonderful, beautiful soul. Mm-hmm. And so when he exploded and his career did all the wonderful things that he did, I was like, I know him. That's why I tell people all the time. It's like, look, y'all don't know who you're going to be working with. Though that extra might direct you one day. That yeah. extra might become a superstar or person bringing you your coffee might produce your next movie. So you really shouldn't be kind to people for that reason. You should be kind because you should be kind. But
that's true. Absolutely.
You know, you're just good to people. But also, you never know what they're going to end up doing.
You know, Jack Kay, I don't know if you saw this video. I did. It was recently. Told the story of when she worked on 227 that Kenya Barris was a PA on the show.
Right.
And did you see this?
No, I didn't see it. No, okay. I missed this interview.
She tells the story is about how it was her and Shirley Ralph. And she tells the story about how Kenya Barris was on the show 227 and would bring her coffee and stuff, and how mean she was to her. She admits it. How mean she was to him. And she said now she's seen him out and he remembers that. And he says he reminded her about how mean she was to him. Yeah. And he's Kenya Barris now.
Yeah, of course. He's amazing. And there is nobody that can say that about me.
Nope.
I love people. You know what I'm saying? I'm good to people because I want people to be good to me. That hasn't always happened. But that should not change how you are to others.
You know, that's the thing. You don't do it for, you know, you mentioned it earlier, for some sort of return or reward or something out of it. You do it because it's the right thing to do.
Exactly. And even those that find you repulsive, because there are people that just don't like you for whatever reason. They think they know who you are. Mm-hmm. It's very difficult, and it takes a very evolved person that prays and meditates. Mm-hmm. But you still have to be kind to them. You don't have to take things. You can respect yourself enough to take yourself out of the situation, but don't let anybody bring you low. That's one of my favorite things that Michelle Obama ever said. When they go, you know, when they go low, I go high. You know,
right?
And that's just and I've had to do that a lot in my career.
Yeah. Well, you know, I want to get to your career a bit because, in the '90s, which is when I was very familiar with you, and I was actually just starting out myself. Mm-hmm. You had a couple of films in particular. There was Dorothy Dandridge too. Mm-hmm. But when you did One False Move, I thought that performance from you, which I didn't know, but I just read that you were nominated for what's the Independent Award? The
Spirit Award, the SAG, oh, SAG, yeah. After. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And you deserved it. And so, you know, I just thought that film was excellent. I actually have a clip of that here that I want to play too. You got a minute? You sure you do? You're here. So let's play that for a second.
Shit, that trooper's behind us, man.
Don't look back. Just be cool.
What do we do if he pulls us over?
He ain't gonna pull us over.
Slow down, Ray. Don't panic.
He recognized me back here, man. I know he did.
If he recognized you, he would have arrested you in the store. He's just looking us over. White boy and a nigger girl in Texas, that's all it is. Right now, he's probably running our plates.
542, go ahead.
On your out-of-state plate, New Mexico license number Nora Edward 245. Apparently, the vehicle is recently purchased. There are no warrants, and there's no current registration available.
10-4. Could you check the teletype boards for the last couple of days? I seem to recall a teletype from California, a male and female black, and a male white, wanted for a couple of murders.
Speed up, Ray. You'll make them suspicious.
Man, speed up, slow down, make up your fucking mind.
Have you found that teletype yet?
Still looking, 542.
10-4.
So, Cinda, I didn't mean to do it, I just did. So I just want to talk to you a little bit about this scene because I'm going to play a little bit more of it. The performances in this film were so good. And I think I mentioned to you before that Michael Beach happened to be one of my better friends. Mike and I talk a lot. In fact, he's here in Atlanta right now shooting. First of all, I'm going to get into the prep up because I need a little bit in the mud. Mm-hmm. But how did you get this role? How did this come about that they would choose you for this role after, you know, not Harlem, but Moby the Blues? Was there something that they saw in you from that film where you hired directly? Did you have to audition?
No, I auditioned. I auditioned for this film. It just so happened that I was in New York. I was living in New York. And I happened to get a photo shoot. I was doing this Vogue photo shoot with Denzel. Mm-hmm. And so I was going there. I did not have an agent. I had no representation at all. Did not have a lawyer. But I had become friends with Spike Lee's lawyer. Mm-hmm. And he was just putting my name out there. And he heard about this movie. They had had quite a few auditions. They still weren't happy or made any choices about the character. He was like, while you're out there, I'm going to try to get you in for an audition. So that is how I was able to get in. Carl Franklin, amazing director, already had a choice. He knew who he wanted and it wasn't me. Right. But everybody else wasn't sure. Everybody else was like, you know, let's still keep on looking. And so I did my audition, loved the script. It was a very different script than what it ended up being. It was very, this one is way more film noir. The other one was more of an epic saga. Very different, had a lot more dialogue. It was a beautiful character that I had, all the characters. And so I went back to New York, found out I was going to get a callback. Didn't know how it was going to happen, but I was like, okay. So I prepared for 2 months for the audition, for a callback, for whenever it was going to happen. I went back to LA to do the premiere for Mo Betta Blues. And I went in and had my final call and was able to get the role.
Nice. Mm-hmm. That is something, because this film here, I think that when I saw it is around the time that I first met Mike, and we were doing a play in LA, which is how we met, and I had just seen this, and he was like dangerous in this. So he was badass. He was like nobody you want to meet on the street. Mm-hmm. I assure you, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So so what are your thoughts though on, in terms of, in terms of how this film turned out, in terms of how it was received, I just feel this film deserved a much bigger audience. As a matter of fact, I can't find it anywhere.
So, well, I know that I recently did a bunch of interviews about the movie because they were finally going to put it on DVD.
Right.
And they were doing all the you know, interviewed all the different actors. Well, I don't know who all was involved, but they just released last year a DVD of One False Move. I loved the movie from the beginning. I thought it was so great, but not everybody felt that way because there was so much infighting about the outcome. Right. Billy Bob wrote a different script. Carl took his script and rewrote it and made a film noir. And so there was a lot of disagreement about the film and nobody liked it. And so it got put on a shelf. One of the producers loved it. And of course, you know, she and I loved it. We were the only females.
Right.
And Jessie Beaton was her name. Mm-hmm. And she started sending it out behind their backs. And she got it to Roger Ebert. Mm-hmm. And Roger Ebert is the reason why that movie got any kind of anything.
Really?
Limited release, any attention at all, because he loved it so much. And his partner loved it so much. They ended up making it their number one for the year, their number one movie choice for the year. And because of their attention, the people finally started seeing the movie. But that was even after it had been released. Mm-hmm. So it had a very short run. It was on video, and that's how people started watching it. And it became a cult classic. I remember, I don't know how long ago, it must have been like 15 years ago, I ended up going to a cult classic film festival, and it was in it. And I was like, I am way too young to be at a classic film. But that's how people receive it, is as a classic film noir. And so I was very grateful that Jesse took that risk and put it out there. And a lot of attention, a lot of positive reviews. I'm pretty sure Carl won Best Director for the Spirit Awards. I know Billy Bob was nominated for writing. He and Tom Epperson, who wrote it, they got their due. I got nominated. Unfortunately, I didn't win this year, although the girl that did win, I absolutely loved her performance in the movie that she was in, and I understood why.
You remember who it was who won that year?
I really can't remember her name. She's this really different, dark-haired white girl, always wore black around her eye, raccoon makeup, but she was super dark and did this really dark piece. I can't remember what it was called. But I can't remember her name, but I haven't seen her in a long time, but she was really good in whatever film it was.
Yeah. I just, like I said, I love that film and I love Dorothy Dandridge. I'm going to go back and forward, because one thing I meant to ask you was about how you got Mo Better. I've seen like stories about how you got the film, but I want you to tell us, how did you get on that legendary film with Denzel Washington and the gang? That film is, I love Mo Better Blues, and that's a great cast, a great film. How'd that happen for you?
Well, yeah, it was God and source. It wasn't me, that's for dang sure. I mean, I had just recently moved to New York I graduated from college and in 88 and moved to the East Coast and lived in Connecticut for a while, making money, trying to save enough to move to New York. Moved to New York, thought I was going to do Broadway. That was my plan. Had no intention of doing movies, didn't know nothing about movies or television, didn't consume that. I was a theater person, a church person, and a musical theater person at that. So that's what I thought I was going to do. And I got a job, like so many people do, in restaurants. I was a bookkeeper and a hostess in three restaurants. And people would come in, they got to know me, they were regulars, and they would come in and were like, you need to audition for Spike Lee's new movie. And I was like, I don't do movies. I don't know anything about it. You know, it's a different type of acting. I've really never done anything with it. I haven't even taken any classes. And we're like, it doesn't matter, you're perfect for this role. And several people brought me backstage, the backstage information. And so after maybe five people said this to me, I was like, okay, maybe this isn't just a coincidence. Maybe this is something I need to follow through on. And so, like I said, I didn't know anything about this stuff. I didn't know anything about the process or movies. So I took the information from backstage. I found out where Robbie Reed's, God bless her family. I know she's going through some stuff. Yeah. But I found out about where her office was. She shared an office space with multiple casting directors. So it said that her office opened at 8 a.m. So I let my boss know. I was like, I want to go in and meet these people, try to get an audition for this movie. And they were 100% on my side. Like, go, come in if you have time, whatever, or take the day. So I went in there and I was like, I'm here to see Robbie Reed, thinking it was a man, by the way. And they were like, well, not here yet. The office isn't open yet, so you can sit there. And so there was a circular bench and I sat right in the center of this space and I just started reading. And, you know, it's before cell phones. So I wasn't on my phone. I was reading a book and just, you know, whatever. And they kept coming out and like, are you okay? You've been here quite some time. I was like, yeah, I'm fine. I'm gonna wait till they get here. So after about, I think it was about 11 a.m. Mm-hmm. when she finally came in, and she got bombarded.
11?
Yeah, it was.
You did 3 hours?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so all these casting directors, she told me later, I didn't know this at the time, but all these casting directors came up to her and were like, you need to give this girl a shot. Give her a shot. She's been sitting here since 8 o'clock, quietly, no attitude. She deserves a shot. So Robbie came over to me. She's like, hi, what's your name? And I had not fully invested in CYNDA yet. I was still Cindy. Mm-hmm. Right. And although I was saying Cynda and writing Cynda, I just hadn't got used to it yet. So she's like, what's your name? I said, Cindy. And she goes, oh, okay. Well, everybody here thinks I need to give you a shot. There are no auditions today. The audition is tomorrow, but it's an open call, but I'm going to let you come in and I want to hear you read. Mm-hmm. So that was the beginning of, I had 6 auditions in all. That was the first one a week. Mm-hmm. I went back in the next day and I met Spike Lee along with about 200 other women. Mm-hmm. And I sang 2 songs and I read. And then he started calling me and asking me my opinions and creating the character. Mm-hmm. But I did not get the role until 6 weeks. And by the time it happened, I was like, whatever. You know what I mean? I was just like, if I get it, cool. If I don't, I am not tripping at all because this is a long time. I'm not used to it. I'm used to a couple of callbacks maybe for mm-hmm. theater, but knowing pretty quickly. But he was still calling me and talking about, and let me hear the song and, you know, building the character. So mm-hmm. I was like, well, maybe, but I'm not letting God on this one. But I got it.
And that's kind of how. And the work with at that time, you know, Denzel was still definitely on an incline. He was a star, but he was still building that star in Wesley Snipes as well. So that was mm-hmm. that, you know, you go from what you just described your experience was from literally walking in off the street, it sounds like, doing this film with all these great people. Sam Jackson as well was in that, and Bill Nunn and Wesley and Denzel. So that must have been a quick learning curve for you on that.
Oh, it was a lot. Because like I said, I did not have a background in with cameras or any of that technical side of things. I knew nothing about it. As a matter of fact, in my first audition with Spike, I had commercial classes. So the whole first audition with him, I'm looking straight into camera like you do with a commercial. And he was like, okay, that was good. Now let's do it again and don't look at the camera. That's not how you do it for a movie. I was like, oh, they don't look at the camera. You're right. So I had to learn on my feet. But I had wonderful, amazing actors who none of them I knew anything about. They weren't stars to me. They were other actors as far as I knew. I had never seen any of them in anything.
Never seen any of them?
I hadn't. Like I said, I wasn't a movie watcher. I wasn't a television watcher. I was in church and in theater myself and singing. I was singing all over the place. So I didn't know who they were. They were just other actors that got the role as far as I was concerned.
Right.
Did I notice how fine they were? Absolutely. I did notice that. That was impressive. But I had been preparing for this my entire life. I've been acting since I was 5 years old. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't a big reach for me to be okay. And I remember back in the days before that, when I would audition in Chicago, although it was a very short time in Chicago, I did most of my stuff in Indiana. And they would tell me all the time, you really need to leave this part of the country. You do not look black. You do not look white. We don't know what you are. So you're not going to work here. And you need to do films. You need to do movies. Your acting style is perfectly suited for films. And I didn't know what they meant because I didn't know anything about it. Mm-hmm. But it just worked out. It worked out. And I absolutely loved acting for films. And I pretty much was stuck that way. I did some theater, but nothing like I thought. You just don't know where you're going to go in life. And that's every day for me. I never know where I'm going to end up.
Well, you know, you're a wonderful singer.
Thank you.
And as I said, I bought that soundtrack on the CD and I used to play it all the time. And that song in particular was one of my favorites. It was my favorite song on the CD for sure. And I wore it out. So did you want to do more with your singing, or that just, it just kind of went that direction with the acting more so? Because you certainly could have done, in my mind, more music. Did you kind of?
Well, I was a singer first, actress second. I was a singer first. That's where I began. That's where I started and where I thought, you know, and then, you know, once I started acting, really acting, I was like, okay, musical theater. But There's a few reasons why I didn't end up doing it. One of the reasons was I was a church girl. Believe it or not, naked or not, I was a church girl. And the movie Hollywood has a darkness to it, but the music world has a darkness that I couldn't conceive of participating in. I was afraid. Not to say that the people aren't awesome. I just didn't know how I would survive there because I wasn't that, you know, I wasn't into so many things as so many people did. I just, you know, I just didn't live the way other, I was, and I'm a morning bird or a morning lark, as they call it. I'm not a night owl. And musicians, they do everything at night. They perform at night. They record at night. They do everything. I get up when sun rises and go walking and meditating. And I was just a different personality. That was one. I did have a record deal for a brief second. Everybody wanted me to be Clark. Everybody wanted Clark. They didn't want Cindy, Cinda.
What do you mean? They wanted you to sing songs like that or?
Yes. They wanted the easy in. Everybody knew me as a jazz singer. And they wanted me to be a jazz singer. I'd never sung jazz in my life. I had never listened to jazz until this film. I was gospel. And
you wanted to do gospel? Is that what you said?
No, I didn't want to necessarily do gospel, but that was my background. That's what I listened to. That's what I sang. And I sang pop and I sang rock. And I wanted to be an alternative rock singer before alternative rock was a thing. Mm-hmm. Because that's I write. I lyrically melodies, things like that, and my music just leaned into that style. And they wanted me to do Clark. They wanted me to be Clark. And still, people want that from me. And that's not who I am. It was a character I played, and I just happened to sing. But it's stuck, and it's never gone away. And now I love jazz. I've listened to it all my life and I've been singing it for many years now because that's what people want from me is jazz. So that's what I've done. I'm trying now. I have a few people I'm working with. Finally, I'm trying to do a fusion of jazz and hip hop because I prefer hip hop. I prefer that vibe. But yet my voice is perfect for jazz. And it is. And lyrically, I've matured enough so that I've learned how to write lyrics in a different way. I'm not so talky and I'm a storyteller. And in my music, I would tell stories when I sang. I've matured a little bit when it comes to that. So that's why, you know, they wanted me to be someone I didn't want to be. And I would rather at that point in my life, sing in bands, which I did. I sang all over LA in bands. I sang in New York. I sang in the Midwest in bands, and I did my own music, original music, for a long time. It wasn't until I had my daughter that I started doing jazz consistently. I have a band in New York that I will perform with. I have a band in Maryland, D.C. that I perform with, in Chicago, in Indiana. So I would just go and be featured in all these different bands, and everyone was different. The one in Maryland, Washington was jazz. The one in New York was jazz. The one in Chicago was a mixture of R&B, hip hop, jazz. The one in Indiana was Americana. So I was singing, and that's my voice. I can sing anything. I'm a chameleon when it comes to my vocals, which makes it difficult to pinpoint what I need to sing because I can sing every style. Mm-hmm. Although I'm not a runner, meaning, you know, all that stuff. I can do it, but I don't do it. It doesn't feel natural. So I'm more of a purist when it comes to my tone, like Ella Fitzgerald, like, you know,
like Roberta Flack.
Like Roberta Flack.
Yeah, I hear it. I hear it. And you know, I just look forward to hearing more of you. Or more from you musically, Cinda.
Well, I think it's going to surprise some people when I start. I have three people that I'm working with music now. One of them is like the electronica sound. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to be doing some stuff with him. So I'm going to do some ballads with him. I'll also do some electronica, which I've always kind of thought like house music or whatever, that I could do some vocals on that. It would be some hot stuff. I'm working with a guy out of New York who, it's going to be a fusion of jazz. It's kind of like acid jazz, coming, bringing back acid jazz. And one other person that I can't remember. I think there are two people in New York. Mm-hmm. So I'm working on that. I haven't honestly lately had the ability to create music. I've been going through some a phase when it comes to my writing. I've had to do some new things in my life that, since COVID. And so I had kind of a block when it came to writing music for a while, but it's starting to open up again, making some more changes, more transitions. I'm literally a nomad. I move all the time. I'm moving again. So I don't know where I'm going to plant myself, but I am going to be singing.
That's good news for the world, Cyndi. Good news.
Thank you.
About me right now. It's really more about me. One hit. All right. So, like, let me just wind this up. I don't want to take up too much of your time. Tell our audience, firstly, how we can find you, how we can follow you, and then what other projects you have coming up. You just mentioned music, obviously, but is there anything else we should look out for?
Well, I'm doing a lot of social media stuff right now. Thank God for starting with MySpace and then Facebook. It's kept me relevant. I've been able to keep in touch with my fans and new friends, and I have I don't by any means have the numbers of a star, but I have a healthy amount of numbers of people that I communicate with. And I finally started doing TikTok because too many young people said, why are you on there and you don't use it? So I started doing a thing called meditations or with CYNDA, where I just basically, I started off walking meditations because I walk all the time, and I would talk about what I was thinking about. And it's just 1 minute, boom, in and out, and people love it. And then the other one is Showbiz Sin. I got a lot of information in me, and people were constantly coming to me asking for my advice. So I'm a teacher at heart also. I've done a lot of teaching. So in a minute, again, I keep it short because people's attention spans are very, you know, and I talk about something that has to do with my experience in show business. So I got that. I have several scripts that I have written for myself that I'm on the move trying to produce, and I've written for other people. That has been my bread and butter for the last decade, writing for other people, screenplays. I wrote a book, Pink Panty Confessions. You can find Amazon, whatever books are sold. And then, of course, Facebook, you can find me. I've got CYNDA Williams is my verified page. And then there's CYNDA Will, and then there's the official fan page of CYNDA Williams. People don't want the fan page. They want your personal page. So most people are on CYNDA Williams. Instagram, I don't do it all, but I do most of it. Mm-hmm. You can find me there. And as for working as an actress, I am very picky these days. I got to the point where, you know, things changed with SAG-AFTRA. All of a sudden you could actually get a movie where they want to pay you $50. Right. And everybody want to play $50. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that anymore. I did it. I did do it. I did it. And it was hurting my heart. I was like, what am I doing? I can work at McDonald's and make more money.
Right.
You know, and I would rather work doing something else that is meaningful and be paid a decent wage and wait for the right projects to come to me, or if I see something or hear about it. So quality means everything to me in a script. If it's written well, if they actually have a budget where they can pay me a decent fee, and it says something. I can be a bad person if they want to be, but the movie has to have some hope in it. It's got to have some redemption in it. I'm not doing anything that's going to bring this world any further down. I want to lift it up. And yes. And so that's why I actually haven't worked. This is the longest in my whole adult career that I haven't worked. It's been almost a year and a half. So I hope some things, a few things have come to me. Some really interesting things. We'll see. I'm not stressing it. I'm just taking it literally one moment at a time and trying to let myself be guided to the best possible place so I can still serve, you know, my platform, the acting and all that stuff. As much as I love it. It is not my job. My job is to lift people up, encourage and love people. And if acting and music gives me that platform to, so people will hear my, or sense my light, that's what I care about. I care about helping somebody that's going through something. So I'm just taking it one day at a time, Carl.
And that's wonderful. That's ministry. You have a life call and purpose that you're following. Yes. And that's what you should do with the greatest integrity that you can, you know, and that's really, really cool. So I really like what you just said, because, you know, and then you also mentioned before about how dark this business could be. And that's been kind of a subject that I've been talking a lot with my wife about in terms of myself, because, you know, I'll be 65 next week, Cindy. And yeah, so I'm
happy
reflect on, you know, exactly what I'm doing and the impact it's going to have on the world and on others and on my family and all that. And so I certainly feel what you just said and what you said earlier regarding the business. And, you know, we work in a business where, you know, there is a lot of desperation, a lot of talent, but there's also a lot of desperation out there. And I don't want to be a part of that part. I don't want to be a part of that. I noticed you, to kind of turn here, you did a movie with a friend of mine, Mark Harris. Did you do a movie with Mark Harris?
I did.
I just did a film with him too, in December here in Atlanta.
Okay. He's doing his thing. I'm so proud of him. He's doing his thing. Unfortunately, the project that we did, didn't get picked up for any further. It was called Black and Privileged.
Yes, that's what it was.
And I had a teeny tiny part in it. It was supposed to be more episodes, and then you'd really get to know me. But it ended before that happened. So I just worked with him for a day. But I'd known him from film festivals and stuff like that. He's a wonderful guy doing his thing, I'm very proud of him. Yeah.
He's doing a lot. I mean, he's literally, when I shot the film with him here in Atlanta in December, he shot him two films back to back. And now he's about to release another film and about to start another one. So and I've known him since before he started doing all this back in Chicago. Mm. So,
yeah, I knew him when he was doing the festival. You know, that's when we first met, and he kept saying he was going to do it. And I'm so proud of him that he is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Cynda, thank you for being on my podcast. How do I know you? Well, I bring people that I know people, and I don't know how I know you, or maybe I do. We figure it out. So thank you for being a part of that, a part of this podcast. You are my second episode.
Oh, thank you for letting me be. Come on, in an early phase. Yes. I know it's going to grow. I did the podcast thing for 4 seasons. I loved it, but I got worn out. So that's why I'm doing 1 minute shorts.
Yes, right. I'm doing two at one time. I'm crazy like that.
Doing
this one. I'm doing another one on relationships. It's called Twice Married Brother.
Wonderful.
So that one is going to be interesting. I've only shot one episode of that one, but I'm going to shoot another one. And then my wife's going to join me on that one from time to time.
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah. So that, and I'm going to bring in, I'm going to have one of your castmates from Mo' Betta Blues, Roger Guinevere Smith. He's coming on.
How's he doing?
Oh, he's great. He's going to this show probably next week.
Tell him I said hi. I haven't seen him or talked to him. We did Fearless together. With Bill Nunn and Giancarlo Esposito. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful project, and I really, really loved his work. So I hope he's
a wonderful actor and a really, really great guy. So I worked with him on 2 or 3 projects myself. One project I produced that he was in, and then some things with Carl Weber over there at Tridestine. He and I worked on. So I'm gonna end this podcast with the clip from the trailer from How We Met.
Okay.
Let me sign off. Cynda, thank you for coming on board. And we're going to talk soon, okay?
Thank you, honey.
All right, that's Cynda Williams, y'all. Mm-hmm. Let's go.
Excuse me, sister. All right. Are you a believer?
Well, I believe that I'm late for my pedicure appointment.
I mean, do you believe in God?
Well, let's just say my communication with God has somewhat lessened.
up with it?
I am the interim pastor at Faithful Missionary.
You are a real find for us.
Because you're blowing up, homie. I mean, big time.
Pastor.
Yeah, pastor, homie.
There she is.
There go that backsliding cousin, Divine Matthew.
You seem to have a knack for making people see things a little differently.
You can get the Holy Ghost, but you ain't got to fall out. See, you can get buck wild if you want to. You can even pop lock if you want to.
Do you have any demons, Pastor?
Well, I think Pastor Gibbs is the one who's playing himself. See, I got some dirt on the brother.
Oh, it's the substitute. What are your intentions towards my daughter? Oh, so you just want to hit it and quit it, is that it?
I just don't like the young man's delivery.
It's all good, Rev. Or should I say player?
Well, your dad is still young.
He cares so much about the church, I think he sees it as slipping away to you.
It's been my dream to pastor my own church.
Well, I can honestly say that I like your style. My dad has his way and you have yours.
Is he truly right for our church? Does he have the right style? Is he bringing in the right people?
Dig a well, cut the fat, and get to the meat.
Don't this sound a little Jerry Springer-ish to you?
You mean a little more Maury Povich-ish?
Deacon Wells, you are not the father.
Wait a minute.
God's the father.
Let's just say you don't have a big fan in Deacon Wells.
Reverend Gibbs' sermons are scripture-based.
And these guest singers he's bringing in here is like this is the Arsenio Hall show.
Lord, give me the strength. I don't want to be a failure to myself or especially my church.
I didn't catch your name.
Divine.
Yeah, should have known that, because you are heavenly.
Happiness is when you really feel good.
Jesus walks, folks.
Jesus never walked into his meetings late.
Jesus being late.
I thought it was funny.
No.
Okay, I guess not.
Oh, that I happen.